It is really a supernatural encounter with the Lord that how I come to know Jesus. That was back in 84, for the first time that my ex-boyfriend took me to a Christmas service. I didn't know that he was a Christian because we both spent most of our time in a disco and nightlife. Both of us smoke, drink, so I don't know anything about church, you know. Even though I grew up in a Catholic school, but religion has never been part of me. But there is a search in my heart wanting to know who is God, actually. What is religion? I mean, that was the level that I was at when I was in high school. Anyway, coming back to, upon my return from America to Indonesia, and then this guy was after me, at a certain point after we get to know each other, he said, let's go to church. And he's speaking English to me, and I thought church is a new name of a disco or something in town. And because I was so in love with him, wherever you go, I'll go, you know? But the moment I step into the sanctuary, one of my feet stabbed in it, there was such a bright glow of a ray that is brighter than the sun ray in the 12th time in at noontime. It was so bright until I was so glary, I have to cover my face. But the strange thing is, but there was a cry from deep within me, from my being. All this time, I was about 36 years old then. All that time, I lived my life by my logic. Exist, non-exist, black or white, no such thing as gray area for me. So, and those, I mean, my mindset is all totally controlled by the logic, you know, of my mind. But that time, 24th of December, 1984, at 8 o'clock at night, the moment I stepped my feet into the sanctuary, that bright light, that glow, covered all over me like a canopy. And there was a cry from within me saying, who are you, Lord? And I was speaking in English. Who are you, Lord? Why are you so good to me? I experienced what my mind has been trying to work so hard to get what I got that night. I experienced, I mean, I couldn't express this in just mere human vocabulary. You know, your encounter with God, it's just so awesome. It's just so overwhelming. You cannot explain by a mere just human word. I could say that there was a vacuum in my being suddenly get zapped in, fill in. So satisfying love, joy, I'm being accepted. There is no condemnation. It was such a beautiful experience that I had just as the moment I stepped into that sanctuary. But I was communicating with him though. Now, during the service, I didn't know that my ex-boyfriend was next to me, because this glow was covering me like a canopy. So I was detached totally from the surrounding. I was detached from the pastor. I didn't see a pulpit. I didn't see a stage. I didn't see a preacher. It's just me and God. The only time I knew that I was in church, because my ex-boyfriend nudged my elbow, telling me that the service is over. So, and he was asking me like, what do you think of the sermon? And I said, what is a sermon? You know, the worldly people, we don't understand sermon, preaching, that's not common word. We understand, you know, seminar, conference. And I was trying so hard to explain, but that supernatural experience was so, put me such in awe, I was speechless. And so it went on, but the amazing thing is the next day, something was working within me. That was the first time I knew that I had a conscience. Like he was nudging my conscience, just pulling me and drawing me towards him. And there's always a voice that speaks like this every 5 p.m. every day. So I was in my office room working, and there was a voice that's so audible, as I'm hearing my own voice today, that was the audible voice of the Holy Spirit. Go seek the word. Go seek the word. And I said, I would just close my work, lock my room. I told all my employees, I'm going to seek the word, you know, and you know, because I'm the boss, so they don't question me. I didn't know that my driver was a Christian, although nominal, just for ID's sake, but he was a Christian anyway. And I would direct him where to go from the office to the place, the venue where the word is being preached. I didn't have flyers. I have no Christian friend. It was a direct intervention of the Holy Ghost. Every day without fail, I will be in the meeting where the Word of God is being shared, being preached. Didn't have the Bible, no friend. My driver sat at the back in the balcony. I was sitting alone in the empty area, you know, because it's a weekday service, so normally it's not packed. And it's just an ordinary Indonesian preacher. So I would sit alone and I would be like this. I was so focused on what is being preached. But deep down in my being, there's such like a sponge-like heart that was absorbing everything that's being preached. And every time they sing, I would be weeping. But I don't know what they're singing. The moment the service is over, I ran out from the building, took my driver, get the car, back home, you know. But I was drawn with such hunger and thirst of knowing Him. I was not looking for a miracle. I was not looking for money. I was not looking for nothing for myself, really. I was looking for, who are you, Lord? Why are you so good to me? Now, every Sunday, whether my boyfriend is in Jakarta or not, this Holy Spirit keep on nudging me and say, go get ready. Go to the Word of God. Seek the Word of God. And then I would be driving by myself, go to the church where I first met the Lord. And then again and again, every time I step into the sanctuary, that glow, like a canopy, that's exactly what Isaiah 4 says. And the Lord came like a canopy covering the people of Israel. It would come over me. So I was detached again from the surrounding. It's again between me and God. So about 3.5 years, I experienced the supernatural encounter with God. Yet I never make decision to make Jesus Lord and Savior of my life. And the good thing about God is He don't push people. He don't put the Bible into your throat and then push you to accept Him. He's so gentle. He's long-suffering. He let us step by step. You know, like in the book of Isaiah 28, you know, line upon line, precept upon precept. That's how He make us to understand Him. But I grew to fall in love with Him. Until one day, it was on a Sunday, it was right on the birthday of my ex-boyfriend. So again, he was in Jakarta. We went to that church, same church together. Again, about 12 o'clock, on the dot, noontime, that glow so bright came over me. But this one is with power. My heart was broken. My heart was trembling. I was weeping, not because I was condemned. I was weeping because it was just, I can't express the word right now. I think the simpler word to use is, it was so beautiful. It was so awesome what He's doing to me. Yet He accept me the way I am. That was so beautiful about it. The power of God so convicted me, and I heard the word like this for the first time. If you will confess your sin, He is faithful and just to forgive you. That was the first time that I knew, and I knew, and I knew the reason why I needed Jesus, because I'm a sinner. And then suddenly there was a pull from deep within me, like a magnetic pull, brought me to stand up and run to the altar. There's no altar call in that church. The preacher happened to be American, so everything was in English. I ran to the altar and I fell prostrate on the altar by myself. No catcher, no usher. And then a lot of American intercessor came over to me and said, what do you want me to pray for you? Can I pray for you? And I said, I don't know. Well, why are you crying? I don't know. Well, can I pray for you? I don't mind. The next thing I knew was I was on my feet. And the next thing I knew, I was speaking like this without anybody guiding me. Lord Jesus, I confess I'm a sinner. And during that 3.5 years of a journey to get to know Jesus, I never call Him Jesus. I only call Him Lord. Lord, who are you? I want to know you. I'm seeking for you. But I never call Him Jesus. But the first time I call Him Jesus was 28th of February, 1988. And I said, Jesus, come into my life. I know I'm a sinner. Please forgive me. Wash me with your blood. In Jesus' name I pray. That was it. Maren Hickey used to say, like in her program, just this small little prayer will change your life, you know. And that really happened to me. It just, you know, clicked into me. I remember that moment, you know. And the moment I finished praying, I just walked back to my seat where my ex-boyfriend was seated. And then he was looking at me like, you know, with tears all over my face. My makeup was all messed up. And he said, like, why do you have to cry? You want everybody to know that you have a problem? My instinct was like, what problem do I have? My head was saying like, I got money. I'm a rich woman. I have no problem. You know, if I need a doctor, I flew to Singapore. If I need medicine, I can buy the best medicine in town. I have no problem, you know. But when I want to speak to him, something stopped me. I saw myself being covered like with a crystal clear, bright, white glow. Beautiful. And I saw him covered with darkness, like a cloud of darkness. And then I saw a finger pointing like this. And I heard a voice, light and darkness don't become one. That was the time when I knew that I know this relationship is not a right relationship. This is hurting God. This is not pleasing to the Lord. Not that he's asking me to break off from him, but the way we live, because we were living together at that time, we have free sex, we're just relating like anybody who is relating in the world. And I knew that this is hurting God. And I'm so unclean. Even when we drove back in the car to go to the house of my ex-boyfriend, I was just like manifesting in me. I felt like so unclean. I felt like so dirty, and I wanted like to vomit, to throw up. I didn't understand about deliverance. I didn't understand about that at all. But I just couldn't sit just between, you know, next to him anymore like it used to be. It was restlessness in my heart. And I don't know how to explain it because I didn't have the Bible, no teaching whatsoever. So I just knew, and I know, and I know. I told him that I think we have to separate. If God be willing, we get married, we'll be married. But this is not the way to do it. How I live with you is very unclean and it's hurting God. And he became very upset. I said, you're not going to leave me. You're going to leave me, I'm going to kill you. And I said, I thought you were a Christian. You were the one who brought me to church. Now that I'm in the Lord, I receive Jesus as my Lord, and how come you want to kill me? You hate me to become a Christian? And that was a time that God gave me wisdom. He's not born again. You are born again. I said, what does it mean? He became a Christian because of a family. He was born in a Christian family. But he never had that supernatural personal encounter with me. You have. And so because of the understanding, I don't judge him. I don't fight with him. I don't complain. But we get into a fight one day because he would not let me go and live a proper life where, you know, let me go back to my own house. You know, you stay in the house. We live all, you know, normally as a Christian. We have to live in holiness. We cannot live like this. And I said, don't be afraid. I'm not going to leave you. We're still communicating. We're still meeting. But we don't do what we've been doing. This is hurting God. And after saying that, I will be manifesting. I will be delivering. I will run to the bathroom, vomiting. Nothing come out. You know, it's just like spit, you know. And I knew it's a spirit of uncleanness, adultery coming out of me. Yet, I don't know what deliverance is all about. I don't know. Nobody pray for me. And so, that was during the time from then onward. The urge from God, the conviction from God was so strong, I had to break off. And that was a time when God called me. And during that time, because I was so hungry for God, the first preacher that got into my life was Benny Hinn. So my best friend, he smuggled Benny Hinn's video, gave it to my servant in the house, put it in the video player. I didn't know why. Coming back from the office, I was drawn to play the video, not knowing there's already a video tape being inserted inside. It was Benny Hinn. And you know how he began the ministry? He always sang the song, How Great Thou Art. And every time he sang that song, I would be weeping and weeping. It was like rain pouring down my face. I was so broken. I was so touched by the love of God. And I write down every preaching that he made. Because to me, he's the best preacher in introducing Jesus to me. Who is Jesus, the Son of God? Who is Jesus, the Son of Man? Why does God have the 12th name? He was teaching in South Africa at that time. So I was writing all the preaching. That was my first Bible. The preaching of Benny Hinn. And so every day I will be listening to his teaching. Every 5 p.m. leave the office, go to the house, listening to Benny Hinn. But the amazing thing is, I cannot sing that song when the tape is off. The tape has to be on. Then I can sing, you know? So one day I found out that I have growth on my neck. And my body has high fever. This is after I got saved. So I told my mom, what's going on with me? I have lumps on my neck, you know. And so mom brought me to the best cancer tumor professor, doctor. They couldn't find anything wrong with me. I went to three different hospitals. They check me, they give me antibiotic, strong medicine, no healing, getting worse. I couldn't stand properly. I was swaying here and there. I couldn't stand straight. So I finally said to my ex-boyfriend, allow me to go to my doctor in Melbourne, Australia, where I was studying. I have my private GP there. So I went to Australia, and my ex-boyfriend was with me. But before I went to Australia, my best friend who gave me the video of Benny Hinn, he said, In, I heard that you're going to Australia. Now, you're not going without me praying for you. So we're going to have dinner together. We're going to meet first. And I said, it's impossible for me to go for dinner with you because I cannot stand. I had high fever, 39 centigrade. I hardly can stand. I lost my balance. I said, no, you must come. You must come. You must come. She's very insistent. So finally, I said, okay. But I went to her house so late that the restaurant already closed. When I get to her house, there was a preacher in the house because both of her son has asthma. And every night, the nurse said, there's demons attacking your boys. I say it. So my friend brought in this preacher, used to be a businessman, to cast out the demon from the house, from the kids. And when they finished praying, my friend said, oh, why don't you pray for Indri? You know, she's sickness that the doctor cannot do anything about it. And so he said, so what was the problem with you? What kind of sickness do you have? I said, I don't know. Doctor cannot find it. No symptom. I mean, the symptom doesn't signify anything. Okay, let me pray. When he prayed, it's like going from one ear to another ear. But suddenly I heard a voice far away behind behind me and speaking like this, by his stripes, you are healed. And when I heard that voice, I didn't hear it from here. I heard it from here. And it was like a well being opened up and flowing out of my being. And I was laughing joyfully and I was speaking like, thank you, Lord, for my healing. Thank you, Lord, for the healing. Thank you, Lord, for the healing. And my boyfriend said, how come this lady was one time in pain, sorrowful, and suddenly she's happy, joyful, and then saying, thank you, Lord, for your healing. And I said, okay, are you insane or what? You know, it's such a drastic change. I didn't know it was a holy laughter. So all the way to Melbourne, Australia, going to my doctor in Australia, I was laughing in the plane. I was laughing in the car. I was laughing in Canton and Qantas all the way, 7 hours flight to Australia. And so the stewardess said, are you okay? Are you drunk or something? I said, So I went to the toilet. I thought I'm going to release my joy. So by the time I'm finished, I will be quiet. But the more I release, the more it come out, you know? Just like the well, when you draw the water, it's becoming more and more the spring. And then I came to the Grand Hyatt Hotel, my boyfriend resting. I was jumping and dancing up and down like a little girl, you know, just getting a lottery. So I woke him up about 1 o'clock. Let's go. It's appointment doctor time, you know. Went to the doctor, she checked the throat because if there's a lump, there's supposed to be infection, red of infection, nothing. I have 3 lumps on my groin, on my leg, with my body, on a connection there. 3 used like an almond. There's no infection. So she said, we need to do biopsy. My ex-husband has to go back to Jakarta. I have to go to have surgery. They want to check whether it's a tumor or that it's a cancer. And so my ex-husband said, I need to go home. I cannot stay here. I'm sorry. And I said, it's okay. It's okay. You go. The Lord says, I'm healed. I said, you are crazy. You know, what's wrong with you? I mean, this lump is so big and you tell me you are healed. I'm healed. The Lord said so. But I didn't say Jesus said so. So I got into the hospital, locked the door. It was a super VIP room. Get into my pajama and I will be on my knee every day for 5 days in Melbourne. I'll be praying and lifting my hand and listen to me. I'm not a Christian, you know, this is all new to me. And I said, Jesus, thank you for your healing. Jesus, thank you for your healing. And I was laughing and joyful. And then the nurse came in and said, you know, it's okay. I think you are hallucinating, you know. You are too much drug inside of you. I said, no, nurse, I'm fine. No medicine has been put in me. Yeah, I think from Indonesia, you've been drug over, you know, overdose. And I said, I'm healed. The Lord said, I'm healed. You know, of course, they're not a believer. After 5 days, the doctor tested the blood, everything, nothing. He said, we have to wait for another test, and I'm going to give you the result, but the result can only come in 30 days. So you go home to Jakarta first, and I will mail you the result. But before you leave, let me talk to you, you know, on the phone before you check out from the hospital, because there are things that I need to warn you about. I said, okay. So the next day I was waiting for him. He didn't call until about 1 p.m. My flight is about 4 p.m. And I said, I'll call up his house. The daughter pick up the phone and said, Daddy is in the market. I tell your daddy, he has an Indonesian patient here waiting for a result. Result didn't come. So I went back to Jakarta. My ex-boyfriend said to me, so what's wrong with you? Healed? I said, no, not yet. But the Lord healed me. I said, you are crazy. He said, look at this. It's still, the lump is moving over here. And so the next day, before I went to the office, my ex-boyfriend stopped me and said like this, In, why don't you go to my office? There's one guy who is diagnosed to have AIDS. And so I blurted up to him and I said, I went to the hospital. I was sick. You didn't come to me. Didn't visit me. You left me alone in Melbourne. You didn't pray for me. Now you ask me to pray for somebody I didn't even know. AIDS some more. So I walked out and went to the office. But in the car, God spoke to me. Go seek for a pastor. During that 1 week, I was becoming a driver to the Lord. All I do every day is picking up a preacher, sending to the hospital. The first preacher I got was an Indonesian preacher who's ministering in LA. He's a Javanese. He just came back from Java. They're very soft-spoken, you know, very sweet, unlike Jakarta people. And so I said, sir, please come with me. Go to the hospital. There's one guy who's sick with very bad disease. Oh, what kind of sickness does he have? I won't tell you because it will embarrass him. You just come and pray for him. Oh, I won't be able to do that because I need to know what to pray for. If I don't know the sickness, I cannot pray. I said, please, lah. I mean, you know, God will tell you. Please, lah. So I mean, he's bargaining with me. And finally, I told him, okay, he has AIDS. And when I said AIDS, he jumped and I said, oh, I don't think I can promise you. I said, sir, 11 o'clock sharp tomorrow latest, we meet in the hospital. And so after he prayed, he left. The next day, I went to pick up another pastor. Next day, another pastor. I'm becoming a driver. It's such a miracle because I don't know Jakarta too much. Because I grew up in Honolulu, in Melbourne, in LA. So I don't know much about Indonesia, especially the traffic. But I can drive by myself. Yet I found all the small, small, narrow street where the preachers are staying in people's house. So I was totally under the control and the power of the Holy Spirit. It was not me personally. The Holy Spirit was in control of my life. And so one day, finally, I met this guy, Petrus Agung. He was very young that then. And I said, sir, God told me to pick you up and you need to go. And he said, okay, 8 o'clock tomorrow. So he came with his assistant. And when he walked into the hospital just next door here, and he said, he only talked for 5 minutes. And he said, like, tomorrow, 8 o'clock sharp, bring me back here. I'm going to pray first now. Go home. The Lord said that he will give him power to resist any temptation. And I said, okay, whatever the Lord says. So I sent him back, become the driver. The next morning, I came back again with him. And the moment he said like this to the patient, today, God will baptize you in the Holy Spirit. You're going to receive power to receive any temptation. And so I ran to the window of the hospital, look up to the sky, because I thought God is upstairs, you know, he's up where somewhere. And I said, God, if he got a power, I want that power. I want that same power that this guy is promising. And so I pray like any Christian that I saw saying when they pray, hallelujah. So then when I say hallelujah, I feel blank, dry, nothing, you know. So I tried again, hallelujah, the second time. The moment I say, aha, suddenly out of my belly, come out this flowing of rivers blowing out of me. And I start speaking, I don't know what kind of language I was saying, and I was trembling. And the next thing I know, I was on the floor. And when my eyes was opened up, I stood up, you know, from the floor, and I was holding my head like, how come I didn't have a bump on my head? Yet I fell by myself, no catcher, no usher. And I stood up. The amazing part is the preacher went out, left me alone with the AID patient. And suddenly out of my being come out a voice and saying, in the name of Jesus, you spirit of homosexuality, you spirit of adultery, you spirit of uncleanness and witchcraft, come out of him. And you know, this guy, suddenly he's manifesting and I don't know what's happening with, you know, with him. And he start vomiting. So I pick up a bucket and I'm holding up to him. And suddenly he rests on the bed and he said, Pastor Indri, Ibu Indri, he said, you know, there's pain in my chest. There's no pain. There's a battle. There's a warfare. That was during the Persian war in the Middle East. And I said, what kind of war is there? You know, I don't care what kind of war. let's cast the devil out of you. You know, I was taught personally by the Holy Spirit about deliverance. That was my first encounter with the devil. And during that time, I was so hungry with Benny, and then I went to America. Every 3 months, traveling Indonesia, America, just to attend his crusade. And I got favor from him, favor from his head usher. I could sit in the front row, being a guest from Indonesia. He was so blessed. Indonesian come all the way to America just to be with him. And then when he was in Minnesota, he called me up to the platform. Anybody who needs this anointing to bring about salvation to the family and deliverance in the office, in your ministry. I ran for the first time. The first one to run to the altar was me. So the bodyguard was blocking me. And I said, you're not going to stop me. I come all the way from Indonesia. You're not going to stop me. And suddenly Benny Hinn looked at me and I said, I know that lady from Indonesia. Bring her up here. And you know, that time Benny Hinn was always using a white suit. Open up and throw it to the people. So he opened up his suit and threw it on me, you know. And then he says, bring her up here. Stand her up on her feet, you know. And he prophesied. And he said, multitude will be saved through you. God going to give you a big ministry. But then when I came back to Jakarta, went back to my office in July 93, after Minnesota, 11 o'clock at night, a supernatural presence of God was in my working room. It was, I saw with my spiritual eye, gold sword, this big, not like samurai, strong, two-edged, like triangle, stepped on my working desk. And it was like flaming with fire. And I heard a strong voice saying like this, choose me this day. You're going to choose me or your business. Because my business was my God at that time. And then God said spontaneously, and I said, God, I choose you and I want to serve you the rest of my life. I will not bargain. I will not negotiate nothing. I serve you, Lord. I love you so much. That was the beginning when I know that I know I have a calling from God. And so while I'm still doing my business still running, but I was drawn by Holy Spirit to start testifying who Jesus is in my life. So I travel across Indonesia, no church paying for me, no parents paying for me. I was believing God like nobody's business. I just walked to the jungle, to the small town, to the villages, to the islands, just getting one Bible and the anointing. That's it.